If the analysis was properly done, if the conclusions are fine, then you write up the paper and then you send it to a journal where basically some peer review takes care. Of course, in these days we need to look up journals because there are many journals that are called predator journals. There is often not even preview, and this is just the big business. So for the non-scientific public, it's often not quite clear if this is a predator journal. You can look up on the internet, there is a list that lists all predator journals. Peer review basically just means that a paper is submitted to a journal, then the editor basically decides on the reviewers, which is usually two reviewers, and then the reviewers read the article, they look if the conclusions are sound, they double check the methodology, and then they decide whether or not the publication is, if the manuscript is publishable. Often for hiring journals, there are other criteria, like is it new enough or is it interesting enough? And for really high-ranked journals, they have their policies what to publish and not. So certain type of topics are often not interesting to them. So they go more usually for the, what they think are the super interesting topics. That's not necessarily always the case. That's at least my opinion. I think it depends very much, for example, on how much statistics is used. So in these days we have a reproduction crisis. That means many of the articles don't reproduce, even they seem to be properly done. And one of the reasons is that many people don't understand statistics so really well. That holds true for researchers, but it also holds true for the public basically reading and trying to understand these numbers. Reproducibility basically just means that, say, one research group has found a result, then other people try to reproduce this result, and of course you want that they find the same result, otherwise there is a problem. And that's a problem we had in the last years in quite many fields. Medicine is one, psychology is one, where people systematically try to reproduce studies in particular good high-ranked journals, and they fail to do so. That means many studies that claimed that there is an effect on X, for example, on nuts, on cognition, just didn't turn out to be true. I think it's important to understand that we need more than one number usually to understand what's going on. For example, if there is a campaign to improve education, and before the campaign maybe only one person was educated, for example, to read, and after the population is 3%, that's a gain of 300. But still it means the majority of people cannot. So we need to know two numbers in this case. By the way, is another good way to look at a study is not to ask, is there an effect or is there no effect? What you want to do is you want to ask the question, how big is the effect? For example, if nuts consumption basically prolongs your life, that you might say is significant, but what you want to do is you want to see for how many days, years, or so on, the nuts consumption helps you. That's the number you want to look at. The second thing is what you want to do is just have a look how many participants were there. For example, if a study has just 5 participants, that's very bad. If a study has thousands of participants, that's very good. On the other hand, there is a trade-off. A study with 1,000 participants can lead to significant results even if the effect size is very small. For example, just an extension of two minutes of your life. I would say the first thing is be critical. Don't believe everything. The second thing is just see how much it makes sense. Often there are claims that sound very weird. Potentially they are very weird. Second, just use your basically intuition about whether things can be true or not. And if you think they are not true, maybe have a look. For example, as we just mentioned, look for the effect size. How big are the effects?